Get started now?
Yeah, absolutely.
We have the pleasure of Madhuresh Kumar with us today. He's one of the three national organizers for the National Alliance of People's Movements in India, NAPM. And as part of that role, he coordinates the various alliances that NAPM represents. I checked before coming, their website does list 200 plus partners all over India. And if you have any international linkages, also do let us know your own experiences. Madhuresh has been involved in various campaigns, the Land Acquisition Acts, legislation on development planning, the Food Security Bill, anti-corruption, and housing, among others, housing for slum dwellers. Today's topic is social movements and resistance in India. It's a broad topic. Madhuresh will give us a background to this Alliance of People's Movement, which is such a big umbrella organization, some sort of history, and also his own involvement. And I think he has a presentation for us, so you can decide how, you know, to weave those two. Before I hand over the floor to Madhuresh, I'll call on Nitin Gujaran to introduce the sponsoring organization for today, the Association for India's Development, Boston and MIT Chapters.
Hello everyone, my name is Nitin. I'm a volunteer with the Association for India's Development. AID to me is an organization which works on people's issues, issues that affect the most marginalized people. It is strongly powered by volunteers, many of whom are here, and if you have any questions regarding the organization, please do talk to them. And supporters, donors like you, again, many of you who are here and can potentially can be. We meet every Sunday at MIT between 2 and 4, discuss on various projects that the chapter is going to discuss and you know, many other events that happen as part of the chapter. There are flyers here. There is a beautiful 2014 calendar. Please do pick it up. More details on our website. AID Boston, we have a Facebook page, Twitter. So get connected with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Nitin. So Madhuresh, I invite you to present your talk. So we'll go till about 7:45 with the talk. If you need a little more time, let us know. And after that, we'll have a Q&A session. And please silence your cell phones.
My name is Madhuresh and I'm based in Delhi, and as Umang was saying, I'm part of this group called National Alliance of People's Movements, which was founded in 1990s, early 90s, when India's economic reform process was starting. The right-wing Hindu offensive was on gaining in momentum, and that's also the time when a lot of movements in the country, Narmada Bachao Andolan to name one, or the struggle against a struggle for right to information, that was also picking up. Then the struggle of the Bhopal gas survivors, and there are many other struggles which was going on in the 80s. That was the time when a new social movements in a way in India are credited to have taken birth. And in early 90s was a time when, after having a struggle for on issue specific or project specific issues, there was some kind of understanding and coming within the movements that you can fight a project, you can fight on a particular issue, but unless and until you all come together, because it's a systemic problem, what you are fighting is not one issue, but it's you are fighting against a system. So unless you change that system, things won't change. And for that, you need to come together and try and develop a comprehensive vision, whatever you are fighting for. So that's how the NAPM came into being. At the same time, one of its earlier incarnation called Jan Vikas Andolan, People's Development Andolan, was formed. Azadi Bachao Andolan, Save Freedom Movement. So there were all these different formations which came into being. Azadi Bachao Andolan still exists. NAPM is there. Jan Vikas Andolan merged into NAPM. So these are the two formations which came into being at that particular time. Their initial struggles were in 90s, some of the key struggles was that the WTO, there was a great debate in the country around the WTO, GATT agreements. And then they led huge massive rallies, protest demonstrations, or trying to develop an alternative narrative to the whole trade framework. And this was done also in collaboration with farmers union like KRRS, Karnataka Rajya Raitha Sangathan, or even with the VP Singh led Janata Dal government, Janata Dal party at least, if not the government. But VP Singh was also very much a part of that whole struggle at that time. One of the struggles which NAPM also led in the 90s was against the anti-Enron power plant in Dabhol in Maharashtra. Which was in a way the first of its kind, where the India's electricity was being electricity sector was being privatized. That was one struggle. Then anti-Coca-Cola struggle in Plachimara, Kerala. That was also one of the biggest struggles, which finally has resulted into an act where the plant is shut down, and the victims of that plant's operation in Plachimara, they are to get some form of reparation for the damages which has been caused, but is still lying at the center with the president at the moment, because they refuse to sign that. The pressures are too much on the government. They refuse to sign that bill. So there are many of the struggles which NAPM was involved with, and one of the main focus of NAPM has been about developing a different discourse to the development paradigm. That what is development? How do you develop a development with addressing the needs of equity, justice, and many of these issues? Because in 20 years, the inequality in the country has grown. More if there are some people who have benefited from the reforms process, but in general, the inequality has grown. The people who are at the bottom, they have remained on the bottom, and they have been further marginalized. Like the marginal farmers, they have been reduced to the extent of becoming the laborers, workers in the informal sector. Those who have been rich or in the middle class, they have further gone into the upper side. The social mobility has been there on the one side. So there are many issues with which we are struggling, and some of the things which I'm going to talk about, they in a way highlight what NAPM is facing, but also some of the things which other movements in the country are fighting. And in 90s was a time when many of the movements came together, 2000 onwards has been a time when many of the single issue networks have been formed. And that has its own reason that why, when there was a time when everybody came together, 2000 onwards, you have a national campaign for people's right to information. So all those fighting on the right to information, they come together. Then the right to food campaign, NREGA workers coming together, then the pension parishad coming together, and national fish workers, those who are fighting for right to forests, forest rights. So they all come together, one umbrella. So these issues, so 2000 is the time when this segregation starts happening. So there are now, a number of movements who are there, the coalitions who are part of it. And we are, so NAPM is just one of the, we work with them, we collaborate on various things, and there are also the issue-based networks of which NAPM is a part of it. My role is that I am based in Delhi at its national office. I am one of the organizers who is responsible for many of its national campaigns, and also maintaining the coordination between different different constituents of NAPM, and in a way also being in Delhi, act as it's a spokesperson on various issues wherever it relates to where we NAPM should give a statement or talk about give its reactions to what's going on.
In my presentation today, what I will focus on is that what are the key challenges or some of the key struggles which are there today in the country. It doesn't cover everything, like it doesn't cover the workers' movement, it does not cover the caste movement or even the women's movement or anti-communalism struggles. I'm just going to focus today on the struggles around development, developmental issues. So this is what we have in my aspirations of a new India. This is what the political class of the country is trying to fight for. And this is what they are looking at, either a place at security council. It's not that these are very new. This has always been the case. But now, earlier the debate was on the sustainable development, and there was a different narrative. Now it's high growth rate. So all planning is happening in the country with the view that 8% growth rate is what is needed, and that's how we need to grow on. It's an investment destination for corporation. India is on sale, so they are signing free trade agreements, 1-2-3 nuclear deal. They are even willing to waive off the nuclear liability bill, nuclear liability for corporations who are investing in the country. Monsanto is being welcomed, Walmart is being welcomed, and at whatever cost, meaning that they are free to bend rules, they are willing to bend rules for these big corporations. And I'm sure all of you have been hearing time and again different news reports which come from India. And there is also a break in, if earlier in a post-independence, if we said that the highways, dams, steel plants, airports, they meant development. Now they are saying the infrastructure. Infrastructure is the big buzzword today in the country, where everything around in the country is evolving around infrastructure, that we need to create infrastructure which will actually pave the way for growth rate. Also the logic is that the construction sector is what is driving the growth. So you have to create things. They will have a spiral effect, and which will lead to higher growth rate, investments and everything. And the infrastructure is seen as a bottleneck by those in planning or the government, that this is what is stopping from India becoming a favorable destination for investment. But what is it that as people's movement, we are concerned about? On one hand, and when I say people's movement, then our concerns are about those at the bottom, say 40, 50, 60% of the population, who do not find a coherence with those aspirations. For them, the livelihood issues are at their core. To be able to earn a dignified livelihood is what they are interested in. To be able to hold on to whatever access to land, water, forests they have, they want to maintain that. The fact that they can get what the India's welfare state had promised, education, basic education, primary education, basic health services, basic roads, if they are able to get that. That's their aspiration, maybe to start with. Where that will go, I'm sure people have different opinion about that, where that will go and how we want to grow about and what kind of a country and everything. But this is, anyway, from our side, when we say people's movement, that we are fighting for the basics in a way. And so we are concerned about the uncontrolled growth of obscene wealth, inequality, which I talked about, the market-oriented development, displacement, impoverishment, and the way corporations have come to dominate the political parties and their influence on the whole political process and the policy making, or even on everything. Like Vijay Mallya sits on he's an MP, he sits on the Parliamentary Standing Committee for Aviation. There's a clear conflict of interest. He runs Kingfisher Airlines and he sits on that thing. Naveen Jindal, he himself is a big industrialist, but he is sitting in various committees which decides about how the industrialization will take in the country. Same with the Kamal Nath. Kamal Nath is a big industrialist. He owns, and he was Minister of Corporate Affairs, he was Minister of Commerce. So these are conflict of interest, and where their own assets are growing at a very high speed. Reliance, Mukesh Ambani or Anil Ambani, they are not in power, but they control the ministry, powerful ministries. Jaipal Reddy, who was the petroleum minister, he was removed precisely because he was opposing some of his plans. Now Veerappa Moily, who is the current petroleum minister, he is under a lot of pressure. And he is playing to the tunes of Reliance.
So there's a big scams in making, but our political class is allowing that to happen. Unfortunately, be it Congress or United UPA government, even if tomorrow the BJP or the NDA came in power, situation will remain same, because on the political ideology, they are sold out. They are committed to this idea of market-led reforms or the path of development, what we are talking about. And what we are also concerned about, what I mentioned in the last part, that the vicious cycle of state violence. And this state violence, which is just not in terms of police firing or arrests, it's on an everyday basis now what the democratic movements are facing in the country. And the big trigger for that is the fact what they are using is that there is a Maoist violence in the country, and the Maoists have a pan-India presence. That's what the government is saying. Not that they do have. They do not have it, but they are using the excuse of fighting terrorism or the Maoist violence to suppress the democratic voices in the country. And there is also a very big political cultural shift. The way a state reacted earlier to the what democratic movements were doing. So say 15 years or 10 years before, if somebody sat on a hunger strike, indefinite hunger strike, the government will make an attempt to engage in a dialogue, to listen to them, to do something. Today, somebody sits on a hunger strike, government pays no attention. In my Anna Hazare sat on the hunger strike, for 10 days, 11 days, there was a huge crowd on the road, on the streets. So the government was forced to listen. But very like 10, after 2 months, Medha Patkar was sitting on hunger strike in Mumbai in a slum. Government was not even willing to talk. It's not that she's not powerful, the movement is not powerful. But the fact that now the respect for the ideals, the Gandhian ideals call it, or the non-violent movement or democratic forms of movement, is very little. In which they think they are just not bothered about it. So that's a very different turn of events which has happened. If earlier in your neighborhood somebody was corrupt, then they will say, oh, that person is corrupt. Now 20 years, we are like, oh, that person has made money. So there is no regret for somebody being corrupt. So I think the acceptance of this culture where corruption is seen as accepted, it's a value which people are now cherishing about. So I think there are these also significant changes which has happened, which is also reflective of our political environment in the country today. This is an old map, but why, and it's not very clear, but why I have included it here is just to give a sense that all these dots here, whatever dots are, these are representation of various struggles going on in the country. So if it's like in Odisha here, then we are looking at the struggle against Tata's factory in Gopalpur, Kalinganagar, or a struggle against POSCO factory which is being proposed, or Niyamgiri mining. Same here in the Narmada struggle, Bhopal, Jharjhar SEZ, Raigarh SEZ. So there are all these various struggles. And this map precisely I'm showing just to make a point, and this does not reflect all the movements which are going on in the country. That if the government says that there is a red corridor which comes from Nepal there to here to the central India, and this is the red corridor, which is the Maoist corridor, which is having, which is the greatest national threat, and India must fight it. But the point is that the India's threat, or the threat to the capital today, is coming from all these movements all across the country. So that's the larger democratic threat which government does not know how to handle, how to deal with it. Like, look, just a case in point about the struggle which started in wake of Fukushima nuclear reactor. So Kudankulam is a place where on the tip of Tamil Nadu, somewhere here, this area, there suddenly after Fukushima, where the plant, a nuclear power plant, has been in making for more than 20 years, after Fukushima, they all stood up and said that we do not want this plant to happen. It has been 3 years now, three years nearly, more than that, and the power plant has just started now after a lot of struggle against that. And that's a place where the maximum number of people have been charged with sedition law. nearly 3,000, 4,000 people have been charged with the sedition law. What is their crime? The crime is that these are fisher folks who are saying that we do not want this nuclear power plant in our backyard. And the government does not know how to deal with it. Because every day they lost one case, but they are again back in the front. They are again back on the street, or they are again trying to lay a human siege to the nuclear power plant. The POSCO case is going on for 7-8 years now. And they have not been, now they have been able to acquire the land after all these years. And that too, for a smaller, they had to reduce the project size. And that is seen as the biggest investment, foreign investment in the country, the POSCO investment. So the real threat to the Indian government's design is coming from all these democratic movements. But they would like to project it to the world outside that it's the Maoists who are the biggest threat and we need to fight them. Because it gives them a lever to be able to fight all these other movements, where they can frame you, they can put you behind the bar. Even the small section, section 144, which is about preventing people from assembling in more than 4 or 5 people, that is used many times to keep you in. They can keep you under that law for 6 months without giving you bail. They can keep increasing it. So that's what I mean by they are using these propaganda to suppress the democratic voices in the country today. One of the major struggles which is happening in the country today is the land rights struggle and land rights and livelihood security. And when I say that land rights and why I'm not calling it anti-displacement is that there is a discourse which has happened and which has shifted, in fact, how the positions of movements or articulation of the movements have changed over a period of time. If you look at it from the Narmada perspective or the anti-dam perspective earlier, then they were trying to fight out displacement, and they were trying to fight displacement and say that maybe Narmada has another history, but I won't go into that detail. But the later parts of the Narmada struggle came for that we want a better resettlement and rehabilitation. So they were trying to fight displacement. Similarly, many other anti-dam struggles or other issues. But if in 2006, when the Forest Rights Act was passed, where those who were living in the forests and the government of India finally agreed to the Indian Parliament, agreed to a law which will recognize their right on whatever land indigenous people, Adivasis, have been occupying or living, and also the other forest dwelling communities who have been living in these forests going back all the way to 75 years. So from 2006, 75 years before, which goes even pre-independence, that anyone who can prove that they have been on this piece of land for that long, since 1940 some or 30, whenever, then their right on the land will be recognized. That's a huge victory for the people's movements in the country. Because they will, and I don't know how many of us are aware of the fact that these Adivasis who have been living in these forests, but they had no right, and it's not that they have been living for now. They have been living for centuries, even before the forest department was created. But they had no right to build any pakka houses. They had no right, because they did not have a revenue status of the village. The forest villages had no status of a revenue village. So they had no access to schools, no roads, no PDS, nothing, because they do not exist on the village. They were on the mercy of the forest guard, on the mercy of the forest department. So they faced tremendous exploitation and harassment from them. And evictions at will. In the name of conservation, they were evicted from their livelihood, they were evicted from their own places of residence, thrown outside the, because every time a national reserve would be declared, national reserve meant displacement for all these communities who were living in the forest. So that one act, after a lot of a struggle, meant suddenly people were fighting for, suddenly their rights over the land was recognized. And when Nandigram and Singur in 2007 and 8 happened, then the whole discourse of the country, in the country, amongst the movements changed. Because suddenly they could see that what they were fighting for is to defend their right over the land. So the Nandigram struggle was about defending their own land. They do not want to give this piece of land for the setting up of a chemical hub. They do not want to, people in Singhu did not want to give their piece of land for setting up of Tata Nano, on which the middle class of India will arrive. There's the cheapest car, they want to have a cheapest car. But cheapest car for whom? So they said, we do not want to give our land and we want to protect our land rights. So that's the whole discourse changed since then, and the fight against the special economic zones turned into a fight for the land rights. And then there is also a discourse within the movements and understanding that the reforms which are ongoing in the country, apart from our own political class buying onto that idea, and Manmohan Singh and others who take the credit for it, but where are they coming from? Manmohan Singh was a World Bank employee. He still gets pension from the World Bank. Montek Singh Ahluwalia, where is he coming from? All these guys were at the World Bank, IMF, and then the signing of the WTO. So they, in a way, have been pushing this. And 1990s, many of you are aware that how India got into all these reform processes, how on what terms IMF gave India a loan to tide over its fiscal deficit at that particular point. And the Indian people's movements are very, in a way, advanced in the understanding that this is, that the cause is just not immediate, that there is a larger, wider economic phenomenon which is guiding all this resource grab, and we have to fight back. So this is a very old picture from early 90s when there were massive demonstrations against World Bank. And Narmada Bachao Andolan in 90s, when they led the fight against the World Bank, then for a whole decade, that World Bank was not funding the big dams. In 1993, they had to withdraw from the Sardar Sarovar project. And for the whole decade, until the setting up of the World Commission on Dams, they did not fund any big dams. Their whole policy got a shift. Now that they are again back into it, because they are saying that the coal power plants are bad and the hydro is renewable, so we will fund hydro projects. So that's a shift which has taken place. This is again an old image, one of the yatras which NAPM had undertaken. I think this is sometime in 2003 or 4, where Desh Bachao Desh Banao Yatra. So this is one of the images from the WTO Go Back. So as I was saying, that this is what, if post-independence, there was this buying into ideology of the fact that trickle-down theory, that the development, if it happens at some place, then it will trickle down at the bottom and people will get the benefit out of it. That theory, in a way, got challenged. And people, I think, when the students' movements happened in 70s or Naxalite movements happened in 70s, then there was this whole disillusionment with what was going on in the development process, that it was not benefiting. But now again we see that our fascination with the big ideas and big projects has come back. We are again back to planning big projects. The special economic zone was one such idea, where 40,000 hectare special economic zones were being given to Reliance or to other corporations. Now we have, the special economic zones could not take off because of various protests, financial crisis, the problems with the land acquisition. Now they have come up with something called National Industrial Manufacturing Zone. And another mammoth project which is now going to have influence all over the India, and that's another tool which they have devised for the land grab. And they are hoping that this will, in a way, fuel the growth which I was earlier talking about, the infrastructure-based growth. That's called industrial corridors. So they have one corridor coming from Delhi to Mumbai. They have another one from Amritsar to Calcutta, from Calcutta to Madras, Madras to Bombay via Bangalore, then Bangalore to Mysore. So all these corridors they are building on. And if I just explain Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor, the amount of land and resources what it requires, the size of it. So this is what Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor looks like. It starts from this red line is the dedicated freight corridor. It's a railway line which will be primarily dedicated for setting
for transport of goods. And this is a port here, so the port accessibility to the hinterland of India. But alongside this, what they have created is that 150 kilometers this side and 150 kilometers this side, they will have, they will set up manufacturing zones, they will set up industrial areas, investment regions and industrial areas. Every investment region has a size of 20,000 hectares. An industrial area has a size of 10,000 hectares. So that's what they will be building, nearly 12 or 13 each, going from all the way from here to Delhi. The influence area of this project involves 12% of India's landmass, and 17% of India's population is under its influence area. When I say influence area, they are saying the 17% of India's population will be benefiting from it. To us, that's not the case. What we feel is that it's not the 70% of India's population is going to benefit from it, because the amount of damage which it will cause, at least if not 8%, half of it will be influenced by it in a negative way, not in a direct way. The employment generation potential from this, by their own estimate, they are saying they will have nearly 2.5 lakh or quarter million employment which they will generate. So if that's the amount, that is the only employment generation you are going to do, then even if we make an estimate of what the 17% of India's population is, and then if you are going to, if that's the influence you are saying, then why is it your employment generation only limited to 2.5 lakhs? Because that's a big number which is going to be influenced by that. At least nearly 17 crore, which is like 1700 million. So if your estimates are just this much, then why this? And this is a $90 billion project, starting with the investment of Japan in collaboration with the Japan government. Apart from the Japan government, World Bank, ADB, government of Germany, Chile, Belgium, they are all now slowly getting into this. Then from Delhi, from Bombay, they will go on here till Madras, then that corridor, this corridor. So all these corridors are now the plan for them. This whole area is also extremely water deficit, because if you look at the map, this is Rajasthan, and the Rajasthan doesn't have enough water. But that area, they are planning setting up of cities, towns. They have got seven, they are planning to build seven smart cities. One of the smart cities here in Kutch area, Dholera, will be equal in size of Delhi, the existing Delhi, not the NCR, the whole of NCR, National Capital Region, but just Delhi. So that's the scale at which they are looking at. Aurangabad, one of the towns in Maharashtra, is already facing drought in the summer area, in the summertime, but they are planning a greater Aurangabad, which will be equal in the size of Aurangabad. But where are you going to get water for that? There is no plan for it. Just talking of water and how some of the infrastructure which we created post-independence, how all of it is now being diverted for these kinds of projects. And one reason that why we are opposing this is also the fact that this plan comes first. When the government and the planning commission, they plan, make all these plans. The state governments most often know at the next stage. The district administration comes last, third. And the villagers whose land has already been planned, that your land is going to be taken, they don't even know. And if we know India's constitution and the laws, then the Gram Sabha and Basti Sabha has a right over all these issues. India's planning is mandated to happen from the village level, that the Gram Sabha has a role in the planning. Planning Commission has appropriated all these powers. Planning Commission formulates the plan for the whole country. Now what we are saying is that if you pass 73rd and 74th Amendment, and all of these plans are being done and made in the name of public purpose, then why does public has no role in it? That you are saying public purpose, then why public has no role in it? And if that's, and
And people are resisting on the ground. And then they are saying to us that people like you are anti-development. We say we are not anti-development. Plan the development, but ask people first whether they want it or not. Just a case in example that Rihand Dam, which was built in 1960s in Madhya Pradesh, at the border of Madhya Pradesh and Uttar Pradesh, Rihand Dam. There is an NTPC factory also from much before. That dam was created primarily for the agricultural purposes and irrigation purposes. Today, not a single drop of that dam's water goes for agriculture or any such purpose. In Singrauli district and the adjoining Sonbhadra Robertsganj district and the Rewa and all that, they have planned 30,000 plus megawatt of electricity generation. Lanco, SR, Reliance, Tata, NTPC, Dainik Bhaskar, Moser Bear, you name any company, they're all there into the business of power production. So if we have 30,000 megawatts of electricity, we would at least all think that that area, which is called the energy capital of India, that everybody will be having at least 24-hour power supply. They don't have it. None of them have it. So the water has been taken, water has been diverted. In this area also, when we, in March this year, we traveled from Mumbai all the way till Delhi. Twice I have traveled personally. And in many places, you have the cases of that the farmers' land, the khata, where their the information about what is the land record, who holds the land, who holds the title and all of it, no land acquisition notice has been issued, but it has already been marked reserved for DMIC project. The moment it's written reserved for DMIC project, you will not get any loan, you are not able to sell your land, you're not able to do anything. The project hasn't been notified, the project hasn't come in, it's just on the plan. But in the records, your land has already been reserved without even asking you. And people are fighting because they have no other option. This area here, this is in the Raigarh district. Here, they are building, they have planned Dighi Industrial Investment Region. And the Dighi port is in the same area where the Raigarh SEZ was planned. Against the Raigarh SEZ, there was a tremendous fight for 6 years. They fought, finally it was cancelled. They thought, they were very happy that now the struggle is over, we can go back peacefully and do that. But one thing goes, the other comes. So this is what now they have to fight again. So they have again started organizing. There is a 70 village committee which is up there. Thankfully, we just a few months back, we heard the news where the DMIC board, overall board, was saying that we need to reconsider our decision to set up that. I hope they do reconsider it and they do not acquire the land. But the problem is that you can fight one project, but there is more and more coming up. And as a result, what we are struggling at the moment is that, okay, you can fight against this one, but what about the larger fight? And the problem is that we do not have the time, because if earlier you were fighting against one dam here, one thermal power plant there, if you have 30,000 megawatt in your neighborhood, how do you fight? So that's the issue we are facing on the hand at the moment. And people on the ground are just fed up. Like POSCO, after 8 years, they're like, how long one can go on fighting? Narmada Bachao Andolan, they have been fighting for 30 years now. Bhopal gas tragedy survivors, for 30 years they have been fighting. And then they are like, where do we go? What does one do? And I think it's just the great democracy which we celebrate, the fact that India is not, everywhere rebels are not there, are holding on to, people are not taking up the gun. I think it's precisely because of these democratic movements who still have some faith in the into the Indian constitution. Because all the fight is about establishment or the for the rule of law. That whatever we have the laws, let's follow that. But I think that's the battle which everybody needs to support. Because it's very easy to take up the gun. But it's very difficult. Where will it lead to? We have seen what is happening in the northeast of India. Meanwhile, there are a rebel group, there is a rebel group, there is a faction, there is an alpha, salpha, and then surrendered group, all kinds of things. So there is no end to that. And I think somewhere, we have to put pressure on the government from wherever we are, that this is, cannot be allowed. We need re-evaluation of projects like this. And if the pressure doesn't come from Minway, all sections, other we will continue to face this, and there will be always problems. On the energy sector, India has planned that in this year, 13th, 14th, they want to add 100,000 megawatt of electricity. And for past 2-3 years, almost every year we have been adding 20,000 megawatts of electricity, which has seen an increase, because earlier we were having problems, and until I think 2010, we only had a capacity, until 2006, our capacity was 1,60,000 megawatt installed capacity. And now it's 2,25,000 megawatts of electricity. But does this increase make any difference in our own figures that 40% of India does not have any electric connection? Rest 60% who have, what is the amount of electricity they get? How many hours do they get? So even if we are adding these numbers, but where is it all going? It's going to cities. So the urbanization on one hand is good, but urbanization, the problems it is creating and the resources it is taking away from the villages and from the rural areas is extremely dangerous, because we are creating our own colonies. I mean, we are not talking here about what's going on in Bastar, in Jharkhand and other areas from where we are taking up mineral resources. It's just colonies. We are not paying attention, or we are not even treating them as part of our own civilization or even our own country, where people are just crushed. So this is struggle for dignity, livelihood. There are so much which is going on in the country. I'll stop now, and then we can take more questions, because there have been other developments which have happened. I don't know if people are interested in talking about the corruption movement or the anti-rape movement or the new experiment which is happening about Aam Aadmi Party or something. So we can talk about that. This is just the manual scavenger bill finally has been passed in the last parliament session. Hopefully this will end. I don't know. The struggle of the LGBT groups that was also gained a strength from one of the the High Court judgments, Delhi High Court judgment, where Section 377 was repealed. Housing and urban center, that's another big issue which is a problem for all across the real estate development. In fact, a lot of land grab, what is happening, is because of the just filled by the real estate needs. And an example that how real estate and urbanization or the industrialization is linked is the fact that most of us know that Delhi had a lot of small manufacturing units, and they earlier had cotton mills and others in earlier time, but they had a small manufacturing units until 90s, when the MC Mehta filed a public interest litigation in Delhi, and then many of these factories were moved out of Delhi in 1998, 1999, 2000. That was the time when they moved out of Delhi. By then, Okhla is one of the industrial areas in Delhi. In 80s, 90s, the government has started planning that we will have new Okhla Industrial Development Area, Noida, which will have industries because once they move out of Delhi. Noida was created. Noida today does not have manufacturing. I'm not even sure if 25% of that area is used by manufacturing. It's all housing and the real estate and offices and complexes. Noida was over, then they said we'll build Greater Noida. So more industrialization. Greater Noida, again the same issue. Greater Noida has now gone into Greater Noida extension. And then I don't know whatever they have been adding to all of it. So the National Capital Region today has districts from Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, even Rajasthan. So the whole of National Capital Region has increased into such a big landmass. And the water, where is water going to come from? From Tehri Dam it's coming, from the Himachal they want to build a Renuka Dam, against which people are struggling and it has not yet taken shape. People are saying, you want to steal away our water and take it all the way to Delhi?
If you really are interested in building cities, then find your own sources of water. Don't devoid us of our water. And I think that's a big challenge. I think there was a time when we were talking about self-reliant villages. Now we have to see how do we have self-reliant cities. And that's one area where there is no thought going to. We are talking about green cities, smart cities, but no thought to self-sustaining cities. And that's a bigger challenge for all of us, in fact. Even for people's movements, we are finding it difficult that as more and more people start living in the cities, and it's not that people come to cities and inequalities disappear, because the inequalities exist, the resource grab exists. But the problem is that how do you organize there? Organizing in the cities is very different, is very difficult also. So we're still trying to find a idiom of or vocabulary of organizing in the cities. And that's why a lot of struggles which we see in the rural areas in the country, we do not have such strong movements in the urban centers. Mumbai is one area where we do have such a strong tradition of a struggle, but not in many other cities. Delhi does not have that. Patna does not have that. Hyderabad does not have. Bangalore does not have that. So that's a challenge which we see in the coming years, apart from many other challenges. But this is what, as of where it stands. I'll end here, and I think we can discuss more rather than me talking. Thank you.
Is there freedom of questions? Feel free to ask questions.
Questions or comments also, because I don't think I know everything. There are many people who are sitting here who have done long time studies on this, so they can also add in.
So obviously a lot of work needs to be done, and you guys are doing a phenomenal job providing a platform to different regional movements, uniting them under a common platform. Obviously corporations and other interests you deal with have scale, so you're acquiring that scale, you're raising public awareness, you guys are doing a phenomenal job. So obviously we can list down probably few dozen projects that did not work. I would love to hear from you if there are actually any large-scale projects which work, where the government, the industry, and the local population work together to come up with a solution. And you know, everybody won in that process. So do you have any projects in mind in recent history that actually worked, which we could use as a model project? Second thing I wanted your opinion on was, you know, as many colonies in Africa and Asia gained independence in the 40s and 50s from their colonial masters, most were agrarian, but we see a lot of countries have transformed themselves into technological powers, Singapore, Korea, Taiwan. If you look at some of the, forget monetary statistics, if you look at some of the statistics like literacy rate, infant mortality rate, life expectancy, like Korea and India were very similar in the 40s and 50s. But you know, while progress has been made in India on all these quality of life indicators, other countries have much higher development. They have a much higher quality of life on these metrics. There are much higher monetary metrics in terms of GDP and so on. So have you looked at other national development plans, and is there something we can learn? The third thing I wanted to, was very curious about, is anti-corruption drives.
What about anti-corruption?
Means just you know that was one of the things your organization focuses on. But while you touched on lot of problems and the good efforts that you are doing, I would love to know specifically more about anti-corruption drives and what have you done, what do you think has worked, what can we do better.
Three questions.
Okay. So projects that work, where everyone benefits too.
Projects that work, I don't know of any.
Very optimistic.
No, but as far as the solutions to those projects are concerned, See, most of the projects, wherever like we are fighting, we have always also come up with solutions. And we have proposed it. Like if you take the example of Narmada, position to the Sardar Sarovar Dam. There was a whole plan given to the government of India saying that you can have minimum damage and still go ahead and build the dam. Which meant lowering the height, then changes in the structural design, because NBA also worked with a lot of engineers. There are many engineers who came with them. So they, and water experts and others, they actually came up with the whole design. The government of India did not accept it. Not even willing to take a look at it. Forget about accepting or anything. Similarly with the POSCO project. POSCO project also, the movement has said that what can be done and what should not be done. Even in the Singur factory. In the Singur factory, there was a suggestion made that not to take this particular land, but take the other land, and also that the size of the project could have been reduced. But the government, I think the arrogance which is there, where you decide that this is the piece of land I want, and this is the only thing I want. So if you have that, then the options are very left. In a democracy, we would expect that there has to be some give and take. But that's not there. Let's look at the, and if you, since you asked about the collaboration and the coming up of that, then in terms of legislation, so the Forest Rights Act is one success where the government, there was a big demand from the ground and something was proposed, there was some negotiation, parliamentary standing committee looked at it, and finally a law which came with which people are also happy. There are problems with it, but people are fighting now to get it implemented. In the NREGA Act, which is a national legislation, meanwhile, it's again part of coming out of the People's Right to Information Act. So these are, and Right to Information Act, it's not that government one fine day woke up and said that, oh, let's have transparency. Nobody wants transparency. So people struggled for it, but you had to lobby, you had to work with the government, pull right strings and create an environment where things like this could happen. So it has happened. But in terms of the individual projects, I'm not aware of. I mean, I'm sure there are some projects where there have been some give and take and people have become beneficiary of that project. As far as our own particular instance of there has been a lot written about, and there is always issues or discussions about that, the fundamental difference between these economies which you mentioned about Singapore and others, starting from population to the many others. But I think somewhere, it's not that India could not have done better. We could not do much more. Somewhere the problem is that the political will. Do we have the right political will? Like primary education, they're getting the literacy rate. India has so many people who are read. Who are literate, who have gone to colleges and other places. What does the government, if the government said, or even the primary health care, that all the doctors coming out will have to do 1 year of compulsory work in the villages. But there is, no, you do not want to do that because that's your, not even vote bank, because you will just be annoying the middle classes. Or the teachers for that matter. That the compulsory, every graduate has to do 1 year of community service or social service. Does that, is that very difficult? No, 5 years, 10 years you do that, your whole country will be educated. But we are not taking such steps. I know there will be initial resistance to that idea. And people love talking about China, that how China has become great and look at the economic strides it had made. But if one way to take China's example and say about the Cultural Revolution, that how every person in the urban centers were sent to the villages to teach, then nobody wants to take that example, because that goes against our interest. So we don't want to do that. We will only consider what we see, that China plans a big mammoth project building highways in the Tibet, and it does it, repressing everybody else. And they say that, oh, why are we even listening to these people? There are thousands of people, just crush them. And that's what we want in our country. In fact, there are many times when we have discussions and we talk and they say, India needs a military rule. And this fascination with the military rule, I don't know where it comes from.
But many middle class people in today India, they are saying we want that because it will just the politicians are so corrupt and all kinds of things. As if all we need to do is look into Pakistan and see that how military is so good and grand, or look into Burma. You know, we both are military rulers. But I think that's not the solution. And I think we have been struggling with our democracy. And sometimes we say that the democracy itself is a problem because it means taking along a large, diverse population. And these countries, what we, you also just mentioned about, I'm not sure, when they got independence in 1947, everybody above a certain age got a chance to vote. Many of the Western countries also did not have the full voting rights to every man, woman, and all of that. So I think India went on a very different experiment, and which I think we are still struggling with. We have failed on many counts, but also on some counts, I'm sure we have done good in terms of just maintaining our democratic structures. Many people say that this democracy is a facade, which we have just created, and we say that we are a great democratic nation. But I think if you ask many of these democratic movements who are fighting, they won't say that. They will say that it's a democracy and we are fighting to establish that democracy. I forgot the third question.
Third question was
maybe you take,
yeah.
You take some others.
I just would like, if you could talk a little about the role of the left front, so-called left front, that a lot of the Western media seems to be picking up on this.
Now, in terms of general elections coming up?
Yeah, the general elections, and then also in generally speaking, how the left front factors or plays into the movement that, or NAPM, like how and how large is it and how much influence does it have? And then also, just another point that I'm curious about is about the involvement of youth, because there, it seems that now the future of India really rests in the fact that 40% of its population is under the age of 26. And is it that more youth are getting involved in politics, or is it that most of this so-called young population is actually under below poverty line and not involved and not as educated? So how's that actually playing out in India?
So the left front engagement. So when we talk about left India, then it's the parliamentary left on one hand, and then all these movements what we are talking about, that's also part of the left. But there is a tenuous relationship between what parliamentary left, how they relate to the social movements. But within parliamentary left, there is CPI, CPI-M, CPI-ML, and then you can go on counting, ML Liberation, ML Red Star, ML CLI, and various diverse groups there. So they have, but still they have a book to follow. And somewhere they are drawing from Marx and Lenin and others. When you come to the social movements, many of the social movements, which are in a way rebelling from what the left was doing or saying, because the questions like, say, the women's question, the development questions, or the question of caste was not addressed by them, or even the traditional trade union movements. And that's why this term new social movements, which was coined, in a way, you can go more into detail of it. But I think there is still a tenuous relationship. Because very recently, 4 days, 5 days, I think last week, Jayati Ghosh, who is one of the key economists, but also associated with the Communist Party of India, Marxist, she has written an essay on emerging left. Emerging left. So even if after all these years, she's still struggling with the fact that how do you see these movements? Because they think that these movements which are there, they are an impediment into creating, or they are an impediment into creating a revolutionary condition. Because in their framework, they would like to see that when the masses are oppressed, and oppressed to an extent that they revolt against the ruling classes, then the potential of a revolution can happen. But because of these movements, they fight, and they get these concessions like, say, NREG, right to work. It's 100 days work. It's not like you have a guaranteed right to work for 365 days. But it's 100 days work. So what it does, that in the rural economy, it ensures that some money keeps flowing. So even though the reforms are ravaging the economy, the rural economy, farmers are committing suicide and everything, but it's still because of measures like this, or the Social Security Act, that these small measures, which are coming because of the people's movement's engagement with the state,
that they are not letting the actual revolutionary condition to happen. So that's a, and they are not able to figure that out. This relationship also came under a stress because the left has been ruling in the state of West Bengal for 30 years. In Kerala, they have been, every 5 years, they have been in an alternate arrangement with the Congress. So in 2006 and 7, when the Nandigram and Singur happened, then that was like a breaking point for the relationship between the left and many of the movements. Because that's the time when suddenly, all across the country, left has been an ally. Even in the parliament, when the Right to Information Act or the Forest Rights Act came in, the CPIM and its members were instrumental in getting these acts passed in the Indian parliament. But in 2007-8, we had to fight against the same people. And that became a breaking point. So even now, the bridges are yet to be mended. It's not that there is a complete trust again. It's still, they are very suspicious of us. That, okay, no, you don't know these, what these guys will do. Like, look at the POSCO case there. The CPI leadership is involved there. We go work with CPI. But at the same time, CPI is not yet very sure how to see their own involvement into the POSCO movement. And that's why the national CPI leadership has never actually put its full weight behind the movement. So there is a tenuous relationship between between the left and the social movements. As far as the youth population is concerned, I think this is, and it will be a very broad generalization which I'll be making, but this, the age group what we are talking about is 25-30. It means most of them were born in 80s or 90s. And the 80s and 90s, so in a way you have no memory of the past, which is the socialist era of India. Socialist mixed economy, whatever, that era of India. You have grown up in the satellite TV era, the mobiles and others. So even completely in an era where the depoliticization has happened. From 90s onwards, if you look at it on a grand scale, the movements like what Jayaprakash Narayan movement in 70, the students movement or Naxalbari movement, that has not happened in this era. The only inspiration you, if you look at, and this is the worldwide, is in 99 when the Seattle, the movement against the Seattle protests happened. And then there was one concentrated era in which a lot of students mobilization happened. And that too, its impact in India was less. The across the world, anti-war movement happened. That also involved a lot of people. But in India, it was limited. In that way, the involvement of, in past 2 years, the involvement of the youth, and that too in the urban centers, has happened more with the anti-corruption movement and with the anti-rape movement. These are the two movements where they all came in and got some kind of exposure. So suddenly you have the population in the urban centers who are working in the service industry, because that's what we have at the moment. They were on the street for the first time and feeling happy about it. Yeah, I'm here protesting. And we have, and people were innovating and having signs saying, history is in making and I'm part of it, during the anti-corruption protests. And they, and even when the anti-rape protests happened in the, like, in the thick of winter, in the middle of winter, they are facing water cannons in front of the Rashtrapati President's Palace. So all these, maybe that's a time when some kind of political mobilization happened. But the problem with the anti-corruption movement remains is, and even the anti-rape movement, that it did not have a theoretical or to say a larger ideological basis to it. That how do you define corruption? The corruption was just limited to the fact, I will not take bribe and I will not give bribe. If you, in a limited way, if you define the corruption, then your understanding of the whole economic system which is creating this corruption is not there. So you feel very happy about it. If you look into the earlier times, these were all ideological or ideology-based movements which had some kind of a backing to it. So your training happens in a very different format. That has not happened in this time. Even in the anti-rape movement, It was about, we want safe streets. That's it. So we are not questioning the whole basis of the governance. That why is it that the government, in spite of having money and everything, is not able to put street lights? Or why is it that the women are getting, the women are not yet out of the patriarchal the patriarchal structure? So nobody is questioning patriarchy. The women's movement, which was there, thankfully, on the street with the large mass, that they managed to get a Justice Verma commission and a committee and some changes in the law. But within the anti-corruption movement, once the India Against Corruption turned into politics, into Aam Aadmi Party, then the whole facade collapsed. So we do not even have a Jan Lokpal or a Lokpal bill. Coming to the rural area, that what is happening there now? In the rural areas or the B or C grade towns in the classification, if you look at the municipal towns and others, their people are struggling with the jobs, and there is a high rate of migration. Like I come from Bihar, and if you go to many of those many of the villages, whenever I go there, there's not many young people there. NREGA at one point did fuel some migration back, and when Bihar in the when the Nitish Kumar, who is now into the second term, when he was in the first term, then there was some employment being generated and there was a reverse migration which people did see. But that was not with the younger lot. It was mostly with the people who had already been away for 10 years, 15 years. They could see that back home there is some employment generation happening, let's go back. So that happened. But there is a tremendous migration which is ongoing in the rural area, and the people are just struggling trying to find whatever we get. So even our own movements which are there in the rural areas, we do not have many young people who are out there and fighting. And those who are nearby the big cities, let's look at the case of Fatehabad nuclear power plant, which is in Haryana. Fatehabad, the older generation of the farmers, they are saying we do not want to give away our land. But the younger generation, they are saying, no, 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 we have to give away our land. Because we do not want to continue farming, because farming is no more attractive. And the government used that, they divided the whole movement, paid off money, and all of that. So the situation is very different in a way into the both contexts. But it's not that it's a very bright situation, where we can look at, and I think this, the jazz of modernization or everything, the choices which we are creating, it is fueling it to a breakneck speed. So everybody wants to get, if today I have a Nokia phone, then I want a smartphone, I want an Android phone, and all of this is fueling. So consumerism is giving a push. And it's having its impact even in the villages, everywhere.
Thanks for this presentation. It was lovely, really. I learned a lot, and I have nothing to disagree with what you've said. I want to ask a question about your use of the term democratic movement. I understand what you mean. You're talking about movements which are directed against big anti-democratic processes, and that is clear. I think my concern in some of the movements that we've seen is that they don't always exhibit very deeply democratic internal function. So we are fighting on one hand against